Your chest feels as if an elephant is dancing on it. You're gasping for air. Sweat is glistening on your face. You're in the emergency room of a hospital. Nurses are hooking wires all over your chest. Another nurse is searching for a vein to start an IV. And yet another nurse is putting a small pill under your tongue. After looking at the monitor and the EKG, the doctor informs you that you're having a heart attack. It's a frightening scene. Other tests prove that there is a blockage in your heart. The doctor tells you what has happened to your heart and then proceeds to explain what needs to be done to repair your heart so that you can continue to live. Are you going to believe everything he says? Or are you going to pick and choose what you want to believe and disregard the rest, which could cost you your life? Thank you for joining me, folks. I preface this study that we're going to embark on with this situation that I hope never, ever happens in your life. And I pray that your health is in good shape at this point. But I wanted to just kind of make a comparison as to sometimes how people can view the scripture, God's word, in the same way. Either they will believe all of it or some of it or in part. So this was kind of a drastic way of explaining what I was trying to get across in this new study I'm going to share with you. But it's very important because it is a salvation question, which has to do with our eternal condition with God or without God. And that is the topic of how there are so many scriptures in the New Testament, more than we normally think of or realize, that are connected to baptism for remission of sins. We're aware of about 8 to 12 scriptures that we all know, hopefully, and have studied and understand and believe and take to heart. But I am going to suggest to you that there are more than you would ever think there would be connected to this command that God gives us to be baptized for remission of sins. So with that, let's get started. This will be about a 50 to 55 minute lesson, and there's going to be a lot of scripture shared with you. So I hope you enjoy your time, and I hope we can all learn something new. Jesus' apostles that he chose were Peter, James, son of Zebedee, John, Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, James, son of Alphaeus, Thaddeus, and Matthias, who replaced Judas. These men testified about the events they personally witnessed. Reference 1 John 1, verse 1 through 4. They were gifted with the Holy Spirit from God in Acts chapter 2, verse 1. Later, in Acts chapter 9, Saul of Tarsus, who becomes known as Paul, was added as an apostle for the Lord's work with the Gentiles. The scriptures I will be sharing here come from the inspired pen of some of the apostles and the disciple Luke in the book of Acts, after Jesus' ascension into heaven. Now, an important note to remember is, though the apostles were not perfect men, they had perfect teaching and understanding throughout the New Testament. And why was this? Because they each had the direct teaching and the inspiration of the Holy Spirit from Jesus himself. Therefore, they all had the same gospel teaching and the proper response to it from the Holy Spirit, and could not forget, reinterpret, nor get it wrong. Since we know this to be true, teaching by all of them was exactly the same in this regard. In all of the apostles' missionary journeys, even the ones the New Testament is silent about that in fact occurred in the first century AD, the call for alien sinners to respond to the gospel and be baptized for the remission of sins, and God's plan of salvation was set for eternity, even to the present day. So, what we read and understand in the following examples of baptism's essential element by command, Acts 2:38 and Acts 10:48, in God's plan, holds true in all of the apostles' teachings by devotion and preaching throughout Asia Minor and beyond in the New Testament scriptures. Anything otherwise would be a contrary teaching and the apostles' liars. With this foundation, baptism for remission of sins can be recognized and understood as a response to God's calling whenever we read an accounting of the gospel being preached by the apostles or a reminder by them in the letters written by them. For example, Romans chapter 6. For it is an essential part of God's plan that cannot be omitted if one wants to be saved. Therefore, the command to be baptized for remission of sins is connected to all New Testament scriptures that state just faith, belief, confession, and repentance by and of themselves and are disclosed in the Word. An example of this is in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 9. How do we know this? By the sum of God's Word is truth, as referenced in Psalm 119, verse 160, and man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God, as noted in Matthew chapter 4, verse 4. This, followed up by the Great Commission in Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20, by Jesus himself. This will be addressed in more detail. Human wisdom is not sufficient. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. Proverbs 1 verse 5. And let no one deceive himself. If anyone among you seems to be wise in this age, let him become a fool, that he may become wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. For it is written, he catches the wise in their own craftiness. And again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are futile. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18 through 20. Baptism for remission of sins is connected with many scriptures. How does the Bible student handle silence of the command of God to be baptized for remission of sins in other scriptures surrounding salvation? The principle of adding together all God's revelation is vital in any Bible study. It is easy to err if one teaches a conclusion before weighing everything the scripture says on a topic. When the Philippian jailer asked Paul and Silas what he must do to be saved, they replied, "Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved." Acts chapter 16, verse 31. Is that all there is to it? Well, many think so. But when the Jews on Pentecost asked Peter the same question, he answered, "Repent and each one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins." Acts 2, verse 38. Further reading in Acts 16 implies that Paul went on to tell the jailer the same thing. Neither Acts 16, 31, nor John 3, 16, nor any other verse contains all that God says about salvation. The sum of God's word is truth. We are not saved by one thing to the exclusion of all others, for there are many factors that work out our salvation. Rather than focus on just one passage that speaks of our being saved, we must learn the truth of what Jesus said. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Again, Matthew chapter 4, verse 4. Anything which God declares is necessary to salvation in certain passages of Scripture must be implied in all other passages which speak of salvation. Honest people must recognize that we are governed by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. We can't pick and choose which commandments of God to obey. Arraying one scripture against another is rebelling against God, for he gave all the scriptures. As the Apostle Paul wrote, "When ye receive from us the word of the message, even the word of God, ye accepted it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God, which also worketh in you that believe." 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13. In other words, if you read it in the Scriptures, it is God's truth. And we dare not try to make one of God's truths contradict another of his truths. We are not saved by just one thing. God saves us, Christ saves us, the Holy Spirit saves us, grace saves, faith saves, repentance saves, and baptism saves. We are not saved by one of these to the exclusion of the others. It takes all of them to accomplish our salvation. So to get us started, here is the connectivity of the elements to scripturally obey the gospel. Hear or heard, as stated in the scriptures, connects believe, repentance, confession, baptism for the remission of sins. Believe or belief connects hear, repentance, confession, and baptism for remission of sins. Repentance or repent connects hear, believe, confession, and baptism for remission of sins. Confession or confess connects hear, believe, repentance, and baptism for remission of sins. And finally, baptized or baptism connects hear, believe, repentance, and confession. So what is this gospel? Let's read 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 8. The Apostle Paul says, "Now I want to make clear for you, brothers and sisters, the gospel that I preached to you, that you received, and on which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I passed on to you as of first importance that I also received, that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day, according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. The following are just a few of over 200 New Testament Scriptures that include, by inference, in the whole Word of God, baptism for the remission of sins as a critical part to the plan of God's salvation. This is based upon the knowledge that the Apostle Paul stated to the Ephesian elders that he declared to you the whole counsel of God, Acts 20, verse 27. And the psalmist proclaims, "The entirety of your word is truth," Psalm 119, verse 160. And added to this, the inspired apostle stated to Timothy, "All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness." This is in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. With this said, the foundation is established that whatever command and directive God instructs us in Christ's New Testament law, the hearer must do it in submissive obedience to his will. It may be pondered, questioned, and studied, and certainly prayed over, but it must be obeyed by the few who will enter by the narrow gate. Matthew 7:13-14. So the first scripture I'd like to share, and there's going to be quite a few here, so please relax, take your time, and let's just listen to what we have to say here. I would really, really appreciate it. The first one is Mark chapter 16, verses 15 and 16. And he, Jesus, said to them, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned." So, whenever we read Jesus or the apostles speaking about believing in him, it brings about a natural response to be baptized for remission of sins, as the Lord commands. So, belief includes such. Luke 20, verse 1. Now it happened on one of those days, as he taught the people in the temple and preached the gospel, that the chief priests and the scribes, together with the elders, confronted him. The gospel preached by Jesus here included the plan of salvation and baptism for remission of sins. John 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Considering that all of God's word is truth and all that he says is necessary to salvation, believe here is not just believing in Jesus. It's obeying the gospel, the full gospel, which includes hearing the word, believing the word, confessing Christ as Savior, repenting of our sins, and being baptized for remission of sins. John chapter 8, verse 31-32. Then Jesus said to those Jews who believed him, "If you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." So the plan of salvation includes hearing, believing, repenting, confessing, and being baptized here as well. John chapter 10, verse 2-3. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the doorkeeper opens, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. Well, here, in hearing the gospel along with baptism for remission of sins as a response, is the door Jesus knocks on. John 20, verse 31. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. So this includes, again, the whole plan of salvation. It's not just belief. Believing is much more deeper and much more meaningful that includes the whole plan of salvation as opposed to just believing. It's very easy just to believe and just believe in one thing. But belief calls us to action, calls us to response. And that includes hearing, believing, confessing, repenting, and being baptized for remission of sins. Acts chapter 1, verse 2. Until the day in which he was taken up, after he through the Holy Spirit had given commandments to the apostles whom he had chosen. Now, you wouldn't normally think this has anything to do with baptism for remission of sins, but we need to remember that the apostles, remember, in Acts 2, were given direct and perfect teaching about the plan of salvation, including baptism for remission of sins. This was given to them through the Holy Spirit. Acts 2:38, then Peter said to them, "Repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." This is an obvious command here to be baptized and to have your sins cleansed from you. Acts 2:41, then those who gladly received his word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. And then in Acts chapter 4, verse 32, "Now the multitude of those who believed were of one heart and one soul. Neither did any one say that any of the things he possessed was his own, but they had all things in common." So they had responded to the gospel by believing, repenting, and confessing Christ as the Son of God and being baptized. They responded to the gospel, and then they all had everything in common, not just physically, but spiritually as well. They were of one mind, of one spirit, one church. And now we move on to Saul, who becomes Paul on the way to Damascus. Acts 22, verse 16. "And now why are you waiting? Arise and be baptized, and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord." And next is Acts 26, 16. "But rise and stand on your feet, for I have appeared to you for this purpose, to make you a minister and a witness both of the things which you have seen and of the things which I will yet reveal to you." So, in these two verses, Jesus confirmed the plan of salvation to Paul, for which he had seen many sinners come to the waters of baptism while persecuting them. Yes, Paul witnessed and had reported to him many Christians being baptized. So baptism during this time when he was persecuting the church was actually an identifier, a clue for him, in which he probably spied out to catch them and drag them off. This was a very unique thing that they did in the early first century church that Paul had recognized. Ananias would confirm baptism's requirement with Paul, and when he received the Holy Spirit, he could then properly minister as the Lord commanded him. Romans chapter 1, verse 15 and 16. "So, as much as in me, I am ready to preach the gospel to you who are in Rome also. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first and also for the Greek." So here we go again. Baptism for remission of sins is included here. It's not specifically stated, but Paul made sure the hearers knew about it within the gospel he preached. This is all goes back to Acts chapter 2, where Peter made that first gospel preaching to the Jews and gave them the command to be baptized for remission of sins. That's the founding bedrock of the whole message that all the apostles heard and were there and were present when he spoke it through the Holy Spirit to the Jews that day. Romans 15, 19 and 20. "And mighty signs and wonders by the power of the Spirit of God, so that from Jerusalem and round about to Illyricum, I have fully preached the gospel of Christ. And so I have made it my aim to preach the gospel, not where Christ was named, lest I should build on another man's foundation." So if you notice in the scripture, he says, "I have fully preached the gospel of Christ." Well, this obviously includes baptism for the remission of sins as part of that gospel message. The rest of it was hearing the word and for those folks to believe it and to confess Christ as the Son of God, because Paul obviously informed them that Jesus, who was killed, was the Son of God, and that they should believe and repent and be baptized for remission of sins. So this was all included in Paul's preaching. It had to be, because this is what Jesus taught them and showed them through the Holy Spirit. Just because it's not stated in every scripture, as I said earlier, doesn't mean it's not so. So we need to really consider the whole Word of God, the whole message, and put it all together. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 15 and 17. For though you might have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet you do not have many fathers, for in Christ Jesus I have begotten you through the gospel. Therefore I urge you, imitate me. For this reason I have sent Timothy to you, who is my beloved and faithful son in the Lord, who will remind you of my ways in Christ, as I teach everywhere in every church. So the key operative word here is, I have begotten you through the gospel. Anytime we see the word gospel, that means the full gospel, the full message. So baptism for remission of sins was included when the gospel was preached in every church. So the same message, the same responses were needed to become a Christian throughout Asia Minor and through all the churches that he established. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17 says, Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. So now we're going to get into the subject of how do we get into Christ, or how do we put him on? Galatians chapter 3, verse 26 through 27. For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. So here's a very important question for you. Do you believe you must be in Christ to be saved? This scripture describes how one puts Christ on and is added to his body, or the bride, or the church. We must be baptized into Christ by immersion in water for the forgiveness of our sins. Very important. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 19 through 20. Now therefore, you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. So the gospel of Jesus Christ is the foundation, or the rock, the deity, where responding to the gospel through hearing, believing, repenting, and confessing, and baptizing, being baptized for remission of sins, makes one a saint in the household of God. This is a very clear instruction given by God. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 13. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. So here's another question for you. How do we get near and contact the blood? Colossians chapter 2, verses 11 through 13. In him you were also circumcised with a circumcision made without hands, by putting off the body of the sins of the flesh, by the circumcision of Christ, buried with him in baptism, in which you also were raised with him through faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead. Did you catch that? Where and how do we die? Well, we begin by responding to the gospel, where baptism for remission of sins is necessary to be saved, thus receiving the Holy Spirit. Then we have the Helper to teach us and support us on how and what to do while on this earth. We die to ourselves in baptism and to the wisdom of the world, for we are then in Christ a new creature. Through the passive act of baptism and by another's hands, God singles us out, the called from the many, and spiritually circumcises a soul by cutting away the sinful filth from us through the shed blood of his Son, Jesus Christ. We have now contacted the blood and are now cleansed and fit to enter the kingdom as a new citizen, a forgiven child of God. This is glorious news. Colossians 3, verse 3, for you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, 13. For this reason we also thank God without ceasing, because when you received the word of God which you heard from us, you welcomed it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth the word of God, which also effectively works in you who believe. So, part of receiving the word from Paul was the plan of salvation, including baptism for remission of sins. This occurred at every presentation of the gospel on all the apostles' journeys and encounters with new hearers. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 9 through 12. The coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan, with all power, signs, and lying wonders, and with all unrighteous deception among those who perish, because they did not receive the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this reason God will send them strong delusion, that they should believe the lie, that they all may be condemned who did not believe the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. These types in this scripture will reject the plan of salvation and ultimately Jesus Christ. They are ones that are entering the wide gate, which we see so prevalent today in Christendom. 1 Timothy 4, verse 6, if you instruct the brethren in these things, you will be a good minister of Jesus Christ, nourished in the words of faith and of the good doctrine which you have carefully followed. Timothy reinforced the good doctrine he received from the Lord and Paul after his conversion. This included the plan of salvation, which is hearing the word, believing the word, confessing Christ as the Son of God, repenting of one's sins, and being baptized for the remission of sins. Hebrews 4, verse 2. For indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them, but the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. Hebrews 5, 9. And having been perfected, he became the author of eternal salvation to all who obey him. So one must obey the gospel plan of salvation to be saved. Again, we can question it, we can ponder it, we can pray over it, we can mull it over, but ultimately we must obey. Baptism for remission of sins is a work of God, not man. This is essential to understand God's true grace and mercy for sinners. 2 Peter 1 verse 1. Simon Peter, a bondservant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who have obtained like precious faith with us by the righteousness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ. So faith comes from God, not from ourselves. Romans 10, 17. It's a gift once we turn our ear to him. This breeds obedience to the gospel plan of salvation and entrance into his church of Christ. Why do we need faith? Well, because God is an invisible God, and his total plan to redeem mankind requires faith in God to believe. Once we by faith believe, we then can respond to him. And this includes his plan of salvation and baptism for remission of sins, to be clean in his sight through the blood of Jesus. A few more scriptures I'm going to keep sharing here with you, and I hope you're still with me. 2 Peter 1:19, and so we have the prophetic word confirmed, which you do well to heed, as a light that shines in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. The prophetic word, the word of God, includes all of the elements of the gospel to be saved, not just one or two. 1 John 2, verse 7, Brethren, I write no new commandment to you, but an old commandment which you have had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which you heard from the beginning. And that is Jesus and the gospel plan of salvation. It's the same gospel. It's the same plan. It's the same elements leading to salvation. It's never changed and it never will. 1 John 5, 6 through 8. This is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ, not only by water, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who bears witness, because the Spirit is truth. For there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. And these three are one. And there are three that bear witness on earth, the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And these three agree as one. So, the blood had to be shed. We have to be baptized for remission of sins in water. He then gives us the Holy Spirit. 1 John 4, 2, By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. So, and confession includes by the mouth and being baptized for remission of sins. 2 John 1, 4, I rejoice greatly that I have found some of your children walking in truth, as we receive commandment from the Father. Remember, they've got the commandment and the teachings from the Father through Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit way back in Acts chapter 2. This is what he's talking about. The apostles were given the complete detailed instructions from God. They preached it, but not all received it, as we see today in the evangelical world of Christianity. 3 John chapter 1, verse 3. For I rejoiced greatly when brethren came and testified of the truth that is in you, just as you walk in the truth. These are folks that obeyed the gospel, the full gospel. Jude chapter 1, verse 3. Beloved, while I was very diligent to write to you concerning our common salvation, I found it necessary to write to you, exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith, which was once for all delivered to the saints. The common salvation here is found in all that obey God's commands. One of them is being baptized for remission of sins, and a response to the full gospel. Finally, Revelation chapter 14, verse 6. Then I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation, tribe, and tongue. So, out of love, God, through his church, will continue to preach the gospel to mankind up to the very last day. Isn't that wonderful? So I see in this vision here a scene of millions of baptistries flowing with souls not wanting to face the judgment and wrath of God. So why wait? Get it done today so God can see you white as snow through the blood of Christ right now. So in conclusion, I hope you've learned something more about these other scriptures. As you can see, God has much to say about his full plan of salvation, revealing it with so many scriptures to sinners that they might be saved. No serious Bible student affirms that there is any inherent power in the literal or corruptible water of baptism. Certainly, the sinner is washed in the Lamb's blood, but not even that, literally speaking. Instead, It is the spiritual application of the Savior's blood to the sinner's soul, in the mind of God, that supplies the efficacy. Baptism is not a work whereby one earns a salvation. When a person goes forward to be baptized, he does not state that he is already saved through his own perfect obedience. Rather, such a man openly acknowledges that he is a sinner doomed to hell on the basis of his own works, just like the Jews upon hearing Peter's first gospel sermon in Acts chapter 2. In faith that comes from God, he then confesses that he believes that Jesus died on the cross to bear the punishment for his sins and to offer salvation for all men. He believes in Jesus, repents of his sins, confesses Christ as the Son of God who willingly shed his blood on the cross for him, and desires to be baptized into Christ in order that his sins be washed away, to be added to his church, and to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. By this, he acknowledges that salvation is God's gift of grace to him based on the workings of God. Hence, baptism is most definitely not a work whereby man earns a salvation. It is simply one of the five actionable requirements to being saved and blessed with all of God's new gifts to the soul. So likewise you, when you have done all things which you are commanded, say, "We are unprofitable servants. We have done what was our duty to do." Luke 17:10. Then Jesus answered them and said, "My doctrine is not mine, but his who sent me. If anyone wills to do his will, he shall know concerning the doctrine whether it is from God, or whether I speak on my own authority. He who speaks from himself seeks his own glory, but he who seeks the glory of the one who sent him is true, and no unrighteousness is in him." John 7, verse 16 through 18. Then those who gladly received his word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and the breaking of bread and in prayer. Acts 2, verse 41 through 42. Finally, this is one of my favorite scriptures I'd like to share with you, and I have a couple thoughts about it that really bring this home as to the full gospel from God and what one does to be a new member, a new citizen of the Church of Christ. "Now a certain woman named Lydia heard us. She was a seller of purple from the city of Thyatira, who worshipped God. The Lord opened her heart to heed the things spoken by Paul, and when she and her household were baptized, she begged us, saying, 'If you have judged me to be fruitful to the Lord, come to my house and stay.' So she persuaded us." This is in Acts chapter 16, verse 14 through 15. So, in summary, Lydia and her family were Jewish worshipers of God under the Old Covenant. So, how did Lydia hear Paul's message? Her ears and attention was opened. And what did God do to Lydia? He opened her heart. He called her. And what did Paul say to Lydia and her household? Paul gave them the whole gospel and the plan of salvation, including baptism for remission of sins. He told them what they must do to be saved. And what did Lydia and her household family members do? They responded to the full gospel by hearing, believing, confessing, repenting, and being baptized for remission of their sins to walk in newness of life. And then why, after responding to the gospel, did Lydia need confirmation of her newfound faithfulness to the Lord? The gospel of Jesus Christ and the new covenant Paul taught her was new news to these old covenant worshipers. By Paul and his traveling companion's action, she was obviously a newly saved child of God, a new disciple of Christ, and a new citizen of his Church of Christ. Paul and his companions surely would not have let themselves into Lydia's house if the listeners had not properly and fully responded to the gospel. They would have just dusted their feet and moved on to the next house, as was their mission in spreading the good news. Well, there are many more scriptures that I have not shared here in this study that connect baptism for the remission of sins in the New Testament. If you would like a list for further studies, please feel free to contact me at the email address I will leave at the end of this video, and we will send you a copy. It is a very exciting study into the whole truth, God's Word. Have you obeyed the gospel by being submissive to His will on your own cross to be scripturally baptized for the remission of your sins? If you haven't, let me encourage you to continue studying God's Word to where you can just simply follow our Lord's example and so many other examples in the New Testament of how they and how we should obey Jesus' command to be properly baptized into Him and His Church. The truth will truly set you free. Thank you very much for your time, and God bless you.